Good afternoon. Floodwaters have started to drop in the wake of Sydney's rainstorm deluge, but many residents in remote communities remain cut off. SES crews have spent today heading up and down swollen rivers, checking on people and dropping off food and critical supplies. Erin Ramsey reports.
It's a delicate operation that these Hawkesbury River communities are far too familiar with. The SES delivering supplies and conducting welfare checks to residents now cut off from floodwaters. The SES today stationed along the waterway between Windsor and Wiseman's Ferry, bringing food and water to those who didn't get out in time. The main ferry out of action after a cable snapped under the force of yesterday's floodwaters, cutting off direct access for residents in McDonald, St Albans and Webb's Creek.
People can't get across to visit friends, family or people from this side of the river, going across to the shops to buy food, groceries, fuel, whatever they need.
Thousands of residents along the Hawkesbury have been issued evacuation orders over the past 24 hours, many choosing to stay, others unable to get out. This driver needing rescuing after getting his vehicle stuck in floodwaters at Richmond, a similar close call last night at Freeman's Reach. Residents in Torrens Caravan Park, all too familiar with the flood threat today, operating off a generator.
There was a bit of a panic yesterday. Basically, when the water breaches your seawalls and the lawn gets wet, that's an uncomfortable feeling.
Upstream, the Windsor Bridge is still in sight with the levels falling. The Warrego Dam also edging closer to shutting off completely. But the current emergency for residents cut off due to floodwaters still very much remains. While the water levels are falling, the SES is keeping a close eye on exactly how badly damaged these communities are to better prepare for any future weather emergencies.
Communities in Western Queensland are anxiously waiting as the Warrego River near Charleville begins to rise again this afternoon. Meanwhile, in the southeast, strong winds and isolated storms knocked trees over roads and caused hazardous road conditions, with this car flipping near the Gold Coast this morning. Weather conditions across the state are set to ease later tonight. An AFL investigation is underway after Port Adelaide forward Jeremy Finlayson admitted to using a homophobic slur during his side's gather-round win over Essendon. Will Crouch has the story.
Well, this story has certainly soured what's otherwise been a massively successful weekend of football in South Australia, with Port Adelaide's Jeremy Finlayson using a homophobic slur in the Power's win over Essendon. It happened in the third quarter of Friday night's match and was picked up by an umpire's microphone. The 28-year-old then self-reporting his actions to coaches at three-quarter time. Now, he didn't take questions today, instead releasing a recorded statement through the club a short time ago.
I take full responsibility of what happened on Friday night. I addressed it at three-quarter time, and the words I used is very unacceptable in the game of football. We need to stamp it out, and I'm very remorseful. I knew straight away that it's not acceptable, and I take full responsibility of that. And I addressed it at the time, moved on, and just let everyone know what happened, and it's in the hands of the AFL to investigate.
Now, it's understood Finlayson apologised to the player following the final siren and will undergo further education. As for any sanctions, North Melbourne coach Alistair Clarkson was hit with a $20,000 fine for conduct unbecoming during the pre-season, and that incident could serve as somewhat of a precedent. Now, Andrew Dillon, the AFL CEO, expects a sanction to be handed down this week.
There's fresh bail outrage over Melbourne's youth crime wave, with an innocent family in the city's southeast among the latest to be targeted by a teen gang. Gillian Lantouris reports.
A family whose vehicle was stolen by a group of youths is furious that one of the teenagers was bailed just hours after his arrest.
Mr. Joy and his wife returned from a walk on Friday night when they say these youths broke in and took the keys to their brand new Hyundai Tucson.
They opened the door, took the key, within fraction it's gone.
We'll just be more careful, I guess, but that shouldn't really happen.
Using a GPS tracker in the vehicle, detectives found the allegedly stolen car at a home in Sandringham and arrested a 17-year-old boy yesterday morning. He was charged over the theft, among other things. Hours later, he was out on bail.
That's the problem. They are keep on getting bail. They do the same thing again and again. I'm not sure what to do. Yeah, situation is very bad, getting worse.
Nine News understands that teen has been bailed repeatedly in the past for serious offences.
They know they can come back one day and do the same.
The state government still refusing to admit Victoria's bail system is broken.
Victoria has amongst the lowest youth offending rates in the country, but there is a small number of young people who are engaging in dangerous repeat behaviour.
The justice system is a mess under the Allan Labor government at the moment. They're making the situation worse. Against all the best advice, and against our constructive opposition, they've weakened bail laws.
In yet another example of Victoria's youth crime wave, a 65-year-old man was assaulted here in Beaumaris, allegedly by three teenagers who have all been released so far without charge.
Two people have been killed after a car and a motorbike collided in regional Victoria. Emergency services were called to Bendigo, 150 kilometres north of Melbourne, around 10:30 last night. Despite their efforts, both the driver of the car and the solo rider died at the scene. Major collision investigators are trying to piece together what happened in the lead up to the crash. Victoria's asbestos crisis is continuing to grow, with another park in Melbourne's southwest flagged for urgent testing. The Environment Watchdog has identified five parks across two city councils as being contaminated. It's believed illegal dumping of waste is to blame. The EPA is continuing its investigation. The body of an Israeli hostage has been recovered. The father's family says Prime Minister Netanyahu has blood on his hands as the war in Gaza reaches a grim milestone, 6 months since the conflict began. Europe correspondent Jessica Millwood reports.
Thousands of people are protesting in Tel Aviv and other locations across Israel to mark 6 months since the war began. They're calling for an immediate ceasefire so that a hostage deal can take place. But sadly for one family, time has now run out. The Israeli Defence Force announcing that overnight the body of Ilad Kitzir was recovered from southern Gaza. Ilad was taken from his home in Neir Oz Kibbutz on October 7. He has appeared in a number of propaganda videos since, but the IDF believe he was murdered sometime after January. His body has been brought back to Israel. His family say the Prime Minister and War Cabinet have blood on their hands. His sister writing on social media that he was abandoned on October 7 and was then abandoned for 183 days during which he could have been brought back home alive. With the war now entering its 7th month, Israel is continuing to push forward with a planned invasion of Rafah, despite international pressure and warnings it will lead to thousands of Palestinians dying. Ceasefire talks are resuming in Egypt, where a hostage deal will once again try and be worked out. 133 Israeli hostages now remain in Gaza.